You're listening to the For Frequency Sake Network.
Oh, what a day. I had a great day yesterday, and I went and watched my favorite college basketball team's arch rival play a game against Rutgers University, and I enjoyed myself. Granted, because I got to watch, you know, the boys, because they're both at Iowa, play. That's a state championship reference. And I had a good time, only to come home and watch my two favorite NFL teams absolutely shove a dick in their ear for a combined 120 minutes today. Welcome to the Educated Ignorance Podcast. Bit of a blitz edition. We're going to see how this is like the test drive of how fast we can do stuff. because Nick has to work early in the morning because, you know, like early in the morning. I don't know why you changed it, Nick. Your name was fun, was a bit funnier earlier. He had it as I would have been happier if we lost 48-20. So would I. All right. I'm Joe with the show Winkle alongside of Nick Brinks. Nick, we're okay, I guess, right? Can't even see my, oh, wow, it's
can
just.
Can we rewind to like 8:45 when it was halftime and we were feeling good and happy and all that fun stuff? Oh, look at that.
Yeah, you couldn't see it with the fucking. I guess you can't see it at all, my big dumbass, and the way you probably, I need to put it
replace
up here.
Replace the duck. Replace the duck.
I need to replace the duck.
Oh, but first
this is a
fun, Mike, at least.
So
got our hopes up.
So I don't know which one is which, but my roommate's mother got me this one, and my girlfriend got me this one. They did not text each other when they were giving getting gifts for me.
Just put all the on-air signs on all the shelves. Is that a Burger King crown on top?
Yes, on top of Steph Curry.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
Okay, the duck has been replaced.
I just love that your roommate's mother gets you presents.
Well, I mean, listen, that's, you know, we're tight. We're real tight. I got to keep my dad's little camel guy up there for aesthetic purposes.
There you go.
Oh, that looks so much better.
Oh, yeah. I'm an interior designer now.
Yeah, you can like almost see it all the time if I don't. All right, now it's better. Now I can kind of lean a bit. All right. There's 1,000 people that just watched me did that. Not really 1,000, if only. Real quick, if you're watching, like, share, do all those things. You see the rundown on the bottom. This is the start to a big week for us. Or a big stretch of, not week, but a big month for us. We've got the playoffs coming up where Nick and I, you know, are going to team up midweek for each week to do previews. We're not sure if those are going to be live or recorded and then like posted during the middle of the day. We're still going to work that out. I'm going to talk to him. I have an idea and a date set for that. But yeah, we are ready to rock and sock with those. So playoff time, we love it. We both think that the next month of games are going to be very entertaining and fascinating. But we would appreciate it if you leave a like, if you comment, be a part of the conversation. And if you could, go to our YouTube page. You can check it out, or you see on the below, For Frequency Sake QC, subscribe to our YouTube. All right, let's get it started. We got a lot to get to. The Buffalo Bills go into Miami. They win their last five games. They win the AFC East. And the Dolphins with an absolute... just a masterful choke job. Brian Blair asked the question, when will the Josh Allen praise begin?
After halftime?
Probably not. I mean, listen, Josh Allen's the reason the game was close. And he made some plays in the second half. He made a couple of really good ones. He made a nice throw in the first. Listen, we got the full Josh Allen spectrum tonight. We got... the dumbass interception in the red zone. We got the deep ball down the sideline to Diggs. We got him rolling out and just saying, fuck it, someone's down there, and he throws a deep ball that gets picked in the end zone on a 4th-and-1. We saw him fumble the ball in the red zone. We saw him convert a 3rd-down-and-13 with a run. We saw them, Chris Collinsworth, basically bukkakeing himself with the Buffalo bobsled. You know, God, that was fun all night. Watching him and Mike Tirico talk about luge for 3 hours. That was a blast. DJ on a different network. Yeah, Josh Allen apparently has a shoulder injury. You would think the way Chris Collinsworth was jerking the gherkin, he's the one with the shoulder injury. That little clip's going to get gift. Regardless, congrats to the Bills on the win. They were 6-6. They were dead to rights, and they won out. And here's the thing, Nick. They won out also playing. It's not like they've played really good ball lately. They've played like ass for a month. But you get that, you are able to come away playing like ass, playing the Chargers who suck, the Patriots who also suck, and the Dolphins whose quarterback is bad. So, listen, man, congrats to the Bills. They found a way tonight, but to me, this is about this might be biased, I don't know. But this, to me, is more about Miami absolutely bungling it than Buffalo finding a way to win. Am I crazy? Are the two Dolphins fans on here crazy for having that opinion, Nick?
The Bills are 100% the better team tonight.
Absolutely.
The interceptions in the first half and the fumble bump from Josh Allen. Miami goes into halftime up 7. We're feeling good because we're like, you know what? It's kind of house money at this point. We could be down 21-7 if Josh Allen didn't, you know. Hold on a sec. Got a visitor.
Hell yeah, let's go. That's the content people want.
So without that, you know, we're probably going into halftime like, yeah, we're injured. We didn't expect this thing to be all that close. I went in thinking if we are within 14 and it's not a blowout, it's a good day. But when we literally lead almost the entire game, thanks to those turnovers, certainly a big contributing factor. And then we get to the second half. Achan ran the ball really well in the first half, ran it twice in the second half for 1 yard. Frustrating. One first down for Miami in the entire second half before the last drive. That's fun. We get a break. They go for it on fourth down and one. Could have kicked a field goal. I totally understand not kicking the field goal and giving Miami better field position there, but fourth and one, and they don't get it. We have a gift. No timeouts left, but we've got the ball back with plenty of time, about a minute 40 or so. We move it down the field a little bit. We get into opponent territory. And you know what? If the game ends on an interception at the buzzer, 5, 10, 15 seconds left, whatever. To throw an interception with a minute 15 left and it was second down-ish?
We can't. Here's the problem.
The other thing, too, for as great as he has been for this offense, Tyreek Hill has been a damn liability in clutch situations the entire last month. You can count maybe one or two catches per game that should have been easy catches. I looked to last week.
That cat is on your ass tonight.
She's persuasive. Yeah. You look at the game last week, just completely drops one in the end zone. We've had several of those instances over, I think in the Dallas game, there might've been one too. That wasn't necessarily touchdown catches dropped tonight, but I know there was pass interference, so they got the yards, but if he catches that ball, it still hit him in the hands. Despite being interfered with, he was probably gone as DJ. Oops. We both did it at the same time. That may be a touchdown. If not, there's at least some yak with it. Killer. We were so happy in the first half. Like, this is fun. We're having fun. This is a good time. Second half, once we get to, was it the punt return or before the punt return? I think it was 14-7 and we were already like, all right, I think our chance has already passed us by. If not, it was definitely the punt return where we were like, okay, chalk
this
it up.
Is the-
I actually think we were in agreement that the game was lost before Miami gave up the lead. You could just kind of see how it was going.
Yeah. That was the problem. Here's the problem you mentioned. I was going to say
predictable, unfortunately, too predictable. And what did I message you right when Buffalo did not convert that that fourth down and one at the end?
You said Tua pick incoming.
Yeah,
that was funny. Here's the problem. Here you mentioned the pick on second down. On first down, Tyreek Hill should have been doing handspring elbow backflips in the end zone, but Tua throws a hospital ball when he's got it's cover two. He burns the corner. The safety has no shot, but Tua throws these muffins that loft up and down the field when it comes to anything outside of the numbers. It's a disaster. And also, when did the game actually turn on its head? A three-play sequence where it's first and 15. They run that drift route. Tyreek is open. If he hits him on his face, it could be a touchdown, but Tua one hops a 15-yard pass down the middle of the field, and it skips to him, and it gets overturned correctly, and it's incomplete. I've wanted to defend this guy. I want to believe that he can do it because there's flashes. But tonight, just staring you in the face against a defense that's ravaged by injuries. I don't want to hear anything about any of the injuries for either side because both teams are decimated, okay? That's just where we're at. It's why everyone's celebrating the Bills thinking they're going to win the Super Bowl. We'll get to them here in a second. But I don't think it's going to happen because of how injured they are. But the Dolphins against this defense that got gashed all season long. And I know their analytical numbers are always going to be juiced. We've had that adjustment talk. We've put TikToks out about those stupid numbers. The problem that this team scored 14 points, zero in the second half, got one first down before the 2-minute drill. It's mind-boggling. It's staring us in the face. You're never going to win anything of substance with that guy as your quarterback. And it sucks. It absolutely sucks. I hate it. I want him to prove people wrong. But he keeps proving them right. And tonight was another example of it. It just sucks, man. When Mike McDaniel is a wizard, you got people out here saying he was the reason they lost. McDaniel was fucking brilliant tonight.
First half, play calling was fun.
He was brilliant. And you can't win because your quarterback doesn't have the juice to do it. I listen, man, he makes plays. There's times when it's there, but he is a middle of the pack quarterback. He's better than the guy we're going to talk about here in a little bit with the Bears, but he's not good enough to win these types of games consistently. He's not even as good, in my opinion, and tonight showed it, as Brock Purdy. Brock doesn't miss shit like that. Not that often. Especially the play that changed the game, which was the incompletion before the punt return. Purdy has been hitting Ayuk and Debo and Kittle right in the mouth with that pass all season. But it is what it is, man. It sucks. It's where we're at. And I don't know. We're going to pay that dude $300 million at least this offseason. And I just don't know. I don't know. It sucks.
I wish we could have come out of halftime and run the ball. It's not the first time it's happened either. We have success running the football in the first half, and then you just kind of abandon it. Yeah. HM was explosive with the ball in his hand in that first half, and he got two carries in the second half.
Can never stay on schedule in these games. It's a problem of everything. Can't stay on schedule. You can't get runs to go. You miss these open passes. It's just a snowball effect, man, and it sucks. They're going to get killed by Kansas City next week.
Now,
DJ keeps telling me he thinks they're going to get that. We'll be fine, but no, we're not. The Dolphins are not. We'll talk about that in the playoff preview midweek. The Dolphins are not going to go to Kansas City in sub 10 degree weather with that pool noodle armed quarterback and win. They're just not. So, and I'm not even going to be able to watch the game because I'll be doing a Moline game on Saturday night. So, and it'll be on fucking Peacock, which
I have Peacock. But I ain't paying for that. And I'm supposed to do a basketball game. Literally in the first half, I thought, you know what? If we lose this game, I will go to the game with my Kansas City friend in Kansas City. If we still lose this game, because the Bills are, they're outplaying us, but Josh Allen is Josh Allening. But when it was still that close to being in our grasp and we did literally nothing, I'm going to do my game. I'll follow updates on Twitter. I'll stick to my game. And it's just, we, unfortunately, the reality of the situation is this. Monday Night Football, almost a month ago, when Miami pissed the Titan game down their leg, every single Dolphins fan had this moment in their vision.
Yeah, because
Buffalo is going to win the division the final week of the season because we, the Titans game was the beginning of the end for Miami's season, and that was before the injuries just completely started to derail what fun we might have had left.
Like, yeah, they've been snake bitten like crazy.
I will also say this. I'm with DJ to an extent where I say Kansas City does not scare me like they have in other years. I've said that all year. I think since week 3 or week 4, that has been a theme that I have touched on this program literally every week. The Chiefs do not scare me in their current form. Granted.
And real
Dolphins
quick,
don't really scare me right now either if I'm an opponent.
And real quick, I would much
Miami is not going to play well in the cold.
I'd much rather play the Chiefs than the Bills the week after Josh Allen has 1,000 turnovers. Because next week again, you're gonna play the bum ass Steelers and Josh will throw for 350 yards and everyone will think they're gonna be, or the way the Bills have been playing, they could lose that game, if, but probably not. The Steelers are terrible. So I mean, yeah, it's a more favorable matchup because their offense is bad, but it's just not. All right, Brian wants me to, like, he wants the Josh Allen apology. Here is the honest truth about the Bills and Josh Allen. Josh Allen is good, yeah. He's insanely talented. Josh
What's
Allen
your quote
was,
again?
Huh?
What's your quote again?
What? Oh, from the high season? Huh?
From last season?
Oh, the highs are insanely high, but the lows are in the depths of hell. Like, that's what he is.
Tonight we saw it all tonight.
Today was the full pie chart. The full spot, whatever. The full Venn diagram, if that even makes sense, in this situation. Like, here's the thing, man. And this isn't at Brian. Brian is trolling, kind of. Josh Allen is what he is. I will say this right now. At 10, 11 o'clock on the dot Eastern, it is Monday where some people are living, depending on your time zone. It's still Sunday where we live. I will say this right now as God as my witness. The Buffalo Bills are not winning the Super Bowl. The Buffalo Bills are more likely to lose to the Steelers, even though the Steelers are awful. What a gift. This terrible season from the Bills. They're still average. I don't care. I do not care. I just don't. To get the Steelers, honestly, here's the thing. If I was a Bills fan, I would be like, holy shit, we got a gift. They basically have a bye in round one. And then you'll probably host the Chiefs in round two. Where I don't care how average the Chiefs will have looked all season. I will be picking the Chiefs to beat the Bills because that'll probably be what happens. And we're either going to get the Chiefs hosting the Browns or the Texans in the AFC title game. Which if the Chiefs get to host another AFC title game after this season, that's hilarious. Or the Chiefs and the Ravens in Baltimore for the for a berth. To the Super Bowl on the line. If this average ass Buffalo team here, listen, like I understand they've won 5 in a row, but the context here of who have they beaten? I mean, again, they looked like ass against the Chargers and the Patriots, the two games before this. After that Chiefs win, and then that game against the Cowboys where the Cowboys decided to tap out after 7.5 minutes. Okay. If this insanely average Bills team makes the Super Bowl, if I get well actuallyed on this, I will fucking retire from doing this. Okay. Maybe, probably not. And I understand like, oh, this is how you end your curse is a horrible, weird, wonky season. And then you get hot. if this team that can't put two good weeks together in my life gets through all of this and then go, listen, the one thing that is the canary in the coal mine of this is the fact that they get the fucking Steelers next week. It makes me sick that those scrubs get to play Pittsburgh, and Pittsburgh's so fucking bad. And they get to play them next week, man. Jesus Christ.
For the first time all season, we are going to be big Steelers fans.
I mean, I'm going to probably sleep in next Sunday and get up at 2, because why not? That game's going to be a disaster. Steelers are awful. That's not really what I'll do, but yeah, man. Hey,
but what did the Bills do against bad teams?
They play like shit. I mean, yeah, that is true. They almost let Skylar Thompson beat them last year. Listen, man, if you guys want to bet the Bills to win the Super Bowl, congrats. I wish you luck. I honestly do. But you're not like, I will. It's not butthurt. Like, it's not butthurt talk. What have the Bills done? Tonight they found a way. Like, Josh Allen, like, you want the, like, people want the, like, the Josh Allen apology. He's the reason the game was close. He's careless as shit. It's going to be a one-score game against Mason fucking Rudolph next week because of dumbass turnovers, probably. And we'll be sitting here like, what's wrong with the Bills? And then when Mahomes and the Chiefs go in there and beat them, listen, I get it, man. The AFC, they might, they could, but I doubt it. I highly, highly doubt it. Everyone's going to pick them, though, Nick. We all know that. Everyone's going to pick the Bills to win the AFC. Like, we all know that, right? Because the narrative today, if they would have lost, it would have been about the Dolphins getting lucky because of the turnovers and they won't do it 2 weeks in a row. But because the Bills won, that's going to be some tomorrow. The narrative is going to be how great the Bills are and how they're going to steamroll the AFC, right? Like, we all know that's what's coming. Am I wrong? Like, they're probably favorites to win the AFC right now. Look that up. Are they favorites to win the AFC? Because if not, it's got to be close.
Are you talking the Bills?
Yeah.
No, the Ravens are.
Okay, so if the Ravens are like the Ravens are like a -1 and the Bills are like a +2 at worst, right?
+145, +270.
+145, that's silly. Silly.
In order, Ravens, Bills, Chiefs, matches seeding. Then you've got Dolphins, Browns, Texans, Steelers. So basically the Dolphins leap from 6 to 4 in those odds.
That Browns bet would be worth putting $10 on. I doubt it, but listen, man, if the Bills get to the, if the Bills get to the AFC title game, I'll come on here and apologize because they would have to probably go through either Houston or Cleveland or Kansas City to do so. And that's just something I don't see happening. Or Miami again, wouldn't be Miami. Yeah, they will have to go through Houston or Cleveland in the second game to do so, or Kansas City. So if they get to the AFC title game, you will get the full Josh Allen, I'm sorry, I doubted you thing. Which, listen, I'm okay to admit when I'm wrong, but I'm not going to admit defeat. Allen was awful tonight. All right, let's move on. This will be a fun conversation.
Before we do that,
go ahead.
I surprise you really fast.
Yes.
I'm typing it up. One sec.
Okay. Are you sending this to me? Here we go. Brian's mad at me. Here's the thing. Brian's also got upset because the Chiefs are going to play the Bills in the second round, and Brian's a Chiefs fan. So he's going to get
their Bills Chiefs rematch. Probably
Brian, you're going to get your win because either the Chiefs are going to win or the Bills are going to win. And I'm going to have to eat shit in front of everybody, but that's just like, listen, that's just me. I'm not going to, but not really. Falcons fire Arthur Smith. Is that legit?
Mm-hmm.
Whoa. Hello.
Tom Pelissero reports the Falcons fired coach Arthur Smith.
So this is why. Okay.
That's where that came from.
Yeah, on Jordan Ringle, on a positive, yep. Totally off-base note, Bijan, London, and Pitts are free. Bye-bye, Arthur, and his mustache rides. That's a funny comment. So I wasn't on the fire Arthur Smith train until he kind of bitched and moaned today. And I was like, all right, get this loser out of there.
Let Jamal have his touchdown. You already gave up 41. What's 48?
I know. Wow. I guess we can add that to the, I'm going to add that to the thing here. That's a bit wild. I guess Brian just segued it. Good job, Brian. We might as well talk about it, right? Packers, 17-9 win over the Bears. Really short on the Packers, and then we're going to talk about what everybody wants to talk about as Nick makes a run for it. He doesn't want to hear my hot takes about the Bears, so he ran all, he ran away.
I was going to grab a, I was going to grab something off my wall, but it's tacked up there. I thought it was just hanging.
Oh, what is it?
It's a Get Loud Lambo flag from, of my wife's.
That doesn't hurt me today about the Packers.
I know.
Hey man, listen.
It was just relevant. It was relevant. By the way, notice anything gone from my wall? I redacted my flag tonight.
He did. You redacted the Dolphins. Oh, after an 11 win season. That's how shameful we are.
I'll be over it tomorrow, and we'll see how Saturday goes. Watch Saturday. Probably have a chance in the final minutes, and then we throw an interception at, you know, with a minute left.
If I get out of my, I will probably be able to watch the second half. If we get out of my, listen, I just
on Peacock. I'm curious.
Huh?
Or do you have Peacock?
I have Peacock.
Okay.
I got to game it.
Can you share it? Is that something that can be shared?
I could give you the login information, even though it's not mine.
Oh, because I'm the same way. Actually, I will probably be in the car anyway, so I'll just listen on Sirius XM.
There you go. Yeah. So like, I have a game.
That's gonna work out well. That's gonna work out well. I was gonna be doing a game anyway.
Yep. Yeah. But yeah. So I got a game. So that's where I'm at. I'll be watching it on my phone.
Yep.
Okay. Real quick note on Green Bay of this game. Before we talk about what everyone wants us to talk about. The Packers, I kind of have an idea what the spread was because Nick told me that we're going to do a guest the line bit earlier. We're going to completely continue to rip off the Bill Simmons podcast. I think the Packers are an insanely live dog going to Dallas. I think that game is awesome. I'm excited to watch it. Jordan, beyond that, Jordan Love is awesome. Can we like admit this?
He's can we not trade? A,
huh?
Can we swap?
What, Jordan Love for Tua?
Yeah.
Could you imagine?
Can we do that? I'd take that right now.
Could you imagine that dude in our offense? I saw a tweet yet the other day about when will Mike McDaniel get his Stafford? And I was like, man, stop hating on Tua. And then tonight, you know what I was thinking? God damn, when's Mike McDaniel going to get his Matthew Stafford trade? Who's it going to be? Jordan Love, please. I would cry. If the Dolphins did a Tua for Jordan Love trade tomorrow, I would be ecstatic. And the Dolphins could go and win in Kansas City with Jordan Love. They won't with Tua, but they could with Jordan Love. He's not like a top 10 quarterback yet. He's top, like, he's in the 15 to 17-ish range probably. But, man, dude, today he was insane. He had, like, 5 incompletions, over 300 yards. Quick comment on him. What were your thoughts? Like, I thought he was brilliant.
What I have seen out of him since basically, I don't know, before Thanksgiving, dude is just, I can't imagine being a Bears fan because all of the quarterback struggles you guys have had over the years. And my wife's whole family, they're all Packer fans. And so I joked with them like week one, week two, week three, when Jordan Love started off really well. And it's like, well, the Favre Rodgers Love lineage is looking pretty good right now. Then he fell off, struggled for a few weeks there in the middle of the season. And now we get to tonight, number 2 in touchdowns this season. Hell of a season in the playoffs, something Aaron Rodgers couldn't even do last year with a more experienced roster. All of a sudden, it's like, okay, the Bears haven't had a quarterback throw 30 touchdowns in their history, Packers get it in the first year of their new quarterback. It's like the Bears are probably thinking, and the Vikings and the Lions, you know, they're thinking, all right, Jordan Love can't be as good as these other two guys, right? They're not going to get lucky again, are they? And a season in the books, it looks like it's very possible that they indeed did get that lucky again.
By this time next year, he might be the best quarterback in the division, depending on if the Bears do the right thing or not. Just saying, which we'll talk about here in a second. The Packers, like the Jordan Love thing, it's awesome. Then they were great today. The offense was, it should have been 31-9 or whatever. Like, it should have been a blowout. They had a dumb, they goofed the end of the half. There was a drop on a really nice Love throw. That could have been 10 points extra at least. So they fucked the duck a bit in the game. It's why it was close. But Jordan Love was so much better than the other guy, and that is why we're having this conversation. It is year three. I went into today with hope that maybe, just even though I've been out for a while, and everyone and their dad has continued to tell me about how they got to keep the quarterback. They got to keep the coach. Well, let me ask you folks who watch this team and are Bears fans, and listen, my good buddy and good friend, and Matt Freeman, he said it right here. I got to find it. He said, we were complaining about Tyreek Hill. Be a Bears fan. Yeah, no shit. Be a Bears fan. Be me. I cheer for two teams whose quarterbacks make me want to gouge my eyes out with plasticware. And one of them has fans, most of them, not all of them. They are smart fans, but most of them wouldn't understand what good players were if they kicked them in the nuts or the lower extremities every 5 minutes. Here's the problem. Are you a completely brain dead moron if you think the Bears should keep Justin Fields? No. Are you close? No. Some of y'all that I know that like Fields, I get it. I understand it. But then I want a compelling reason, and usually I don't get one. The fact that we are in year three of the Justin Field experiment, and we continue. Remember what I said week one, Nick, when they played this same team? And remember what I said? I'm tired of the excuses. I'm tired of it being everyone else's fault. I'm tired of it being the wide receivers aren't good enough. I'm tired of it being the O-line sucks, which, guys, it does. The O-line today was bad. I'm tired of it being that the offensive coordinator isn't good enough, which, yeah, he's not good. I understand. But, Nick, you remember what I said? I think it was week two or three, and it stuck with me all season. When you blame everybody else, when you blame every other position on the offense and every coach, it's the coaching. It's the coordinators. It's the line. It's the play calling. It's the wide receivers. Do you want to know whose fault it really is? All of that is code for your quarterback sucks. It's code for the dude that throws the ball can't hack it. And he can't. I'm sorry, but I'm not sorry. I bought a canvas with his face on it for Christmas last year because the picture was really cool. I wanted it to work too, guys. I understand. The guy is a great athlete. He'll probably get traded to, as Brian said right here, he'll probably get traded to the Falcons maybe because everyone thinks that would be a cool idea, and I agree it would be fun, and they'll find a way to make it work. But you know what's going to continue to happen while he's in Atlanta probably is he's not going to be able to make enough throws for them to be a serious contender. He's going to continue to have these issues. They didn't complete a pass for an entire fucking hour today against one of the worst defenses in the league. Nick, do you want to know what made me want to gouge my eyes out when I thought about it, even though not really, because like I could give a shit less. Like today was perfect for me, but I just can't continue to combat these moronic fans. Here's a problem that I had that with the today, 2 weeks ago, this Green Bay defense got carved up by Bryce Young and the Carolina Panthers. Shout out to them, by the way, because of them, the Bears have the opportunity. Nick, they have a gift from God. Here's the thing that I don't understand with Bears fans that want to keep Justin Fields. Oh, he's got potential. He's got potential. But shove the potential up your ass. I do not care. I do not care about potential. It is year three. You have two straight years with the first pick. Last year, one of the first quarterbacks taken was CJ Stroud. He might be the second best quarterback in the league. What the fuck are we talking about? They have a chance to reset the franchise by drafting Caleb Williams. Imagine if they trade the pick away and Williams or May turn out to be superstars. Could you imagine? I would not consider them a serious organization if they do that. I just couldn't. And it drives me insane to see the people continuously ram their head into a wall for this average-ass player. He's a good dude. He's a hell of an athlete, okay? There are flashes, but it is year three. Flashes aren't enough. Bears fans would not know what a good quarterback is if it fell out of the sky and landed on them, okay? Like, people don't like Caleb Williams because he cried after a loss hugging his mom, and he said he loves his dog. You know what? Like, sorry, he's a pussy, I guess. Don't draft him. You're stupid. You don't understand the sport. They have a chance to draft a generational talent because the Carolina Panthers are ran by a doofus. Nick, they fleece them so bad. DJ Moore is a fantastic player. They got two first round picks. They drafted a good offensive lineman, a good nickel corner with those picks that they got. Now they have the first overall pick. They also get another top potential. The Panthers are probably going to suck again next year. They have their second. Nick, that's going to be like the 37th pick of the draft. This is one of the biggest fleecings in NFL history. And these morons want them to trade the pick to draft Marvin Harrison. Marvin Harrison is an amazing player. I understand that. But if the Bears trade the pick, and if Matt Eberflus is not fired by this time tomorrow, or maybe Tuesday, I'll give them a day or two, then listen, I love Ryan Poles. He has made every right move, honestly, for a year now. But if they don't do those two things, then Nick, this is not a serious organization. What say you?
Not a fan of Justin Fields, eh? I never would have guessed it.
It's not that I'm not a fan of him, because he makes plays. He does. But we're not in the makes a couple plays business. We're just not. They've made so many improvements. They have shown that they've hit, do you know how big of balls Poles had to have to make the Montez Sweat trade? A year, literally.
What are you doing?
Literally a year after the Chase Claypool trade, they traded the 33rd pick for a guy they cut a month into this season. Think about that. The pick ended up being Joey Porter Jr., who's really good. Not that the Bears would have taken him, I don't think so, but what they could have, because if they hadn't drafted Tyreek Stevenson yet, they wanted a corner. Regardless, they traded the 33rd pick of the draft for Chase Claypool, who is basically a walking DNP right now on the Dolphins, with them having an insane amount of injuries. The balls that Poles had to have to walk in the office, call up the Washington, formerly known as the football team, and offer that same exact trade, basically, because he traded the Panthers pick for Montez Sweat, a dude with an expiring deal, and Sweat went off. The balls that he had to pull that off, like, you, Poles is such a savage for that. Listen, I understand that people don't have faith, but, like, I think he's smart enough to understand Eberflus is getting fired because they got pantsed again by the Packers today, and Fields is gone. It's just where we're at, man. It's just where we're at.
Yeah, I don't really have a whole lot to add. I think it was pretty well when they traded for Sweat. Is that kind of like when the season turned? I haven't followed the Bears super closely, but The fact that the Bears were even in playoff contention in the final couple weeks of the season after how their season started, I give them credit. But as I watched their games, I never got the sense that it was number one making that happen. Sure, he made some plays.
No.
And he, you know, he'll dazzle you with his running occasionally.
But I mean,
throwing the football has never been something that impressed me about him in the NFL.
He makes a couple good throws every now and then. He makes like one play a game that'll make you sit up like, holy shit. He made the touchdown pass to DJ Moore last week, for example, against the Browns, the Cole Kmet touchdown, the play today to Kmet where he like rolled out and then threw it back to him across downfield. Like those types of plays, like he makes one or two of those a game. But that's the thing. It's all flashes. That's all he is. And listen, I think he could go to a team like Atlanta or a Washington or like a Patriots even and like have success. I really do. But it's still not going to amount to much, I don't think, unless you have an insanely super-duper team around them. It's the reason – like, listen, if the here's another thing too. Like, if the Panthers pick, Nick, was like the fifth pick instead of the first – you probably just keep him and you may, I don't think, run it back, because I think today probably sealed Eberflus's fate. Like, they did not look coordinated today. They got gashed again. If it wasn't for Packers' mistakes, they would have lost that game like 31-9. It should not have been close.
That kind of sounds like tonight.
Huh? Yeah, to an extent. Instead of turnovers, it was just a couple dumbass plays because the Packers never turned it over, I don't think. Except for the one where Jordan Love tried to Euro step Tyreek Stevenson and he hit the ball off his helmet. here's the thing about the Bears. They make the Montez Sweat trade the first game they play the Saints, and Tyson Bagent had five turnovers, and they lose. Oh well. After that, they kind of became bum slayers. Everyone points out to the fact that they should have swept the Lions, but they blew that Lions game really, really bad. Yeah, they beat their ass in the second game, but they beat the Vikings 12-10. Remember that Monday night disaster? I think we did a live show after it because it was the Monday after Thanksgiving. They blow that Browns game. Like, the only real good teams they played, they lost to. They lost in Detroit. They lost in Cleveland. And they lost in Green Bay. And listen, the Lions and the Browns game were both very winnable games, but Eberflus made some mistakes. They made some coaching mistakes, and Fields didn't make enough plays, really. He didn't play well in either. His best actual, I would say, performance maybe was the Falcons game. But outside of that, I'm a sicko. I watched the full-length game tape because a guy that I follow for content he did a lot of that for the Bears this year. So almost every Justin Fields game I watched play by play, at least pass by pass, start to finish. And yeah, this is a disaster from an offensive coaching perspective and a quarterback play perspective. It's everything. Everything is wrong. But the fact that you have the first pick, you can reset everything with a roster that's building. They can go sign a Mike Evans or a T. Higgins in free agency. They will have Caleb Willie. You know what? Forget this thing I'm going to say. Jordan, I know you're trolling, but this is also the truth. Nick, do you want to know the biggest reason why the Bears need to trade Justin Fields? Is because if they don't, this is the response from every team in the NFC North.
No. Well, at the end of the game today, did you hear what the fans were yelling at Lambeau?
Yes. Thank you for reminding me, because I forgot. The fans at Lambeau were chanting, "Keep Justin Fields." If they trade the pick, they will be laughed at by every team in the league. Now think, fans, don't think of any sport that you're a fan of. If your team did something where every other team in the league or your division or your arch rivals, if they laughed at that decision and said you were dumb for doing it, and they were cheering, like, the Packers, the Lions, and the Vikings will be cheering if the Bears keep Justin Fields. They will be thrilled. So think about that. Do you want to make your rivals happy? No. So, look, man, I wish Fields the best of luck in his future endeavors. But I cannot wait. I cannot wait, Nick, to cheer for Caleb Williams on the Chicago Bears. Ooh! Even Drake May, if that's the route they go, I think Drake May is awesome, but I think it'll be Caleb Williams. He's like, you just kind of have to. They're both going to be great regardless who they pick. I cannot wait to have them on the Chicago Bears. And they have cap space and two top nine draft picks to build the O-line and D-line depth. They're going to probably draft that number nine pick. They're going to draft one of three players. If they don't trade it, they're going to draft Roma Dunze from Washington. Go watch him tomorrow night in the national title game. He's really good. So there's your wide receiver. Don't lose your sadness, Bears fans or whatever, like all you mopes that are mad they're not going to get at Marvin Harrison Jr. Or if they don't draft him, they're going to probably draft Jared Verse from Florida State or Johnny Newton from Illinois. Those are the two best defensive line prospects in the NFL draft. I have a feeling those are the three guys that they'll be targeting at the ninth pick because they need O-line and D-line depth, and they need a true X receiver. DJ Moore, if they get a true X receiver like a Dunze, or if they go out and get a T. Higgins or like a Mike Evans type, DJ Moore can be put in the slot. They can use him as a rat guy. Then you have an outside receiver, a slot receiver, a tight end. You have all the pieces, and then you just land this generational fucking prospect with the number one pick right in your lap, on your doorstep. It's why they have to do it. Again, like I said, if that Panthers pick would have been the fifth pick, maybe, you probably just keep him, unless Poles gets super aggressive and tries to trade up. But because you got this gift, an absolute gift. And one last thing, I promise, and Nick, I think you'll agree with me here. Doesn't the fact that it's not like no doubt that field should be kept, like the fact that it's an argument, is also another example of why you shouldn't move off of him and use the first pick on a quarterback, right? Don't you agree?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. We'll move on to stuff that Nick probably wants to talk about more than listen to me rant about the Bears. Yeah.
I'm a listening ear.
I'm sorry.
You need to get it off your chest.
You hate me?
I don't hate anybody.
Oh, you're the best.
Well, I'll take that back. I probably do hate some people.
Yeah, there's somebody out there. Nick, how about the Houston Texans? Holy
how
shit.
How about this? What would your little banner thing above your name say if CJ Stroud was one of your quarterbacks?
Oh, my God. Listen, what the Bears did last year, I was fine with.
Pretty passes last night that we were talking about.
Dude, he's so good. It's insane. When I went on my rant there, I said he might be the second best quarterback alive. He might be. Nick, who would you honestly take over him right now? Like, how many people? Because my list is short and I know who it would be. And after that, we're having conversations. All right, like, let me rephrase it. How many quarterbacks, if you called the team and said, hey, Stroud for this guy, how many teams are actually saying no? I stunned him with this one. I should have prepped him.
So how many quarterbacks would I take over him?
Yeah, that, like, I rephrased the question for nerds like me. But, like, if you were the GM of every team in the league, kind of, how many quarterbacks would, if I'm, you know, like, how many quarterbacks would you take ahead? Basically, how many quarterbacks would you take in front of CJ Stroud?
Are we taking current contracts into account?
Yeah.
So we can get CJ Stroud as a rookie on his rookie deal. And we've got what, 4 years on it? Probably.
Five. They have the team option. I mean, because that's when after the fifth year is when the extension would kick in. God.
If you want to take any of the guys that you would consider, you know, Mahomes, Allen, Lamar Jackson, like, you're going to kill your cap space.
Yeah. Even Burrow got the highest paid deal.
If I'm starting right now, either basically taking him with his contract or paying somebody else that's already making a boatload their same contract, I don't know, CJ Stroud and Jordan Love might be the two guys that I guess Jordan Love, his rookie deal's running out.
There's
not a lot left on that.
Yeah.
After what I saw last night, I don't know.
I don't think Love's in that room. Go ahead.
What's going to be the combined cap space for the quarterback in that game next week? And that's going to be my favorite game of the weekend. CJ Stroud versus Joe motherfucking Flacco, baby.
What a shout out to the Browns, man. Oh my God.
You know what? I think maybe one of my least favorite things to come out of the weekend, now that I think about it, is that Houston won the division.
Oh my God, I know.
Houston and Cleveland have to knock each other out in the first round. And honestly, in the entire AFC outside of the Dolphins, I don't know if I would be upset with either of those teams making it to the Super Bowl. Honestly, if one of those teams were the team to knock Miami out of the playoffs, whatever. If it's KC, I'm going to be... No, okay. Let's not go that far. I don't want them to knock my Dolphins out of the playoffs.
Dude, how? But if... No, but listen, think this.
I wanted those two teams to meet later, if anything.
I know, me too.
Possibly my favorite two stories of the entire NFL season, and we have to waste it in the 3 o'clock Saturday wildcard game.
It's going to be the best game. It might be. Now, the Browns busted their ass a couple weeks ago, but Stroud didn't play. So there's a world that exists where this is the best game of the weekend.
I'm looking forward to it.
The second best game. I think the best game. Oh, man. If the Packers show up, they could. That game will listen. The playoffs are going to be awesome.
Storylines for sure. A lot of like revenge games coming up this weekend.
The fact that Rams Lions game is Sunday night. I mean, thank God someone understands the value of good television. I really thought they were going to put that Eagles Bucks game on Sunday night, or the Chiefs game on Sunday night, I guess I wouldn't mind it because the Dolphins would be on it, but. Yeah, man. This Texans team. Shout out to D'Amico Ryans. Shout out to CJ Stroud. They deserve it, man. They've made every right move, and now you have a chance to. But you win the division, and now you have a chance to build on this for the future. And I thought Stroud would be good. I never thought that he would be this. Dude, it has been so fun to just bathe in the Texans this year. This has been a pretty unbearable NFL season, but to just have the Texans as an entity with the feel-good story of D'Amico Ryans, like, he was the original franchise superstar for an expansion team in the Texans, remember? And for him, like, him and Andre Johnson, like, when you think of the pillars of Texans history, those are two of them. And for him to get hit finally, after years of earning for it, him to get his head coaching breakthrough on the Texans, it made so much sense. It was perfect. And for them to go out and be as aggressive as they were to get the quarterback and their edge rusher of the future, and everyone on the draft night to say how dumb it was because they traded their number one pick. Nick Caserio is kicking his feet up right now, smoking a cigar with a hat and a t-shirt on that says division champs, with a roster that went like 2 in 1,000 last year, with Davis Mills, Lovey Smith, and Dirk Cutter, and all of the wash throughs. I cannot, like, the Texans being a thing, man, is so fantastic. Even if they lose to the Browns, and I think the Browns are really, really good, and we'll talk about that with the quick guess the lines, and then of course we'll extend on it on Wednesday or Thursday whenever we do our preview show, because how awesome I think that game's gonna be. Like, it's just, I love it. I love it so much. I love what this Texans team is, man. Everything about it. And this is the baby steps. We're in year one of this experience. I mean, I have absolute, why would you not have anything but faith in them to build this thing into being what we believe it can be with this being the first year, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Way, way ahead of schedule.
Oh my God. Yeah. They're champs in year one.
Obviously, Houston as a whole is just an incredible story this year. But I think one of my favorite sub stories to come from Houston. Let's rewind essentially 365 days, shall we?
Yeah.
Houston with a most likely at the time outgoing Lovie Smith, probably knows he's on his way out, goes for two to win a game, and it costs him the one seed that goes to the Bears, who trades it to the Panthers.
And remember, they got that touchdown on like a 4th and 20 Hail Mary.
Costs them the one seed. Panthers take their pick. Houston, at the time, might be thinking, damn you, Lovie Smith, why did you cost us the number one pick? Is there any Houston Texan fan on earth right now that would have rather seen Houston draft Bryce Young at number one? Now, maybe with D'Amico Ryans, he'd be having a much better season, and Bryce Young is in a bad situation, all that fun stuff. But nobody went into this season thinking Houston was in a good situation themselves. So that's one of my other favorite sub stories. You see how that 2-point conversion, that 4th down and 20 touchdown, how that all played out this season compared to where it could have been. Yeah. And then how we saw the paths of Houston and the paths of Carolina.
Yeah, they veered
this season. Just now, it's kind of funny that Carolina beat Houston this season.
Like, I know.
In the grand scheme of things, that's one of her two wins. What? But still,
you're so right. Like, I wonder if the Texans have any tiebreakers on the Chiefs, because that would have been their 11th win. And could they have been the 3 seed instead of the 4? Like, that's one of their losses. It's hilarious.
Yeah. I'd be curious.
Like, but here's the thing, like, where it's an organizational thing too. Like, Stroud goes out with the concussion. Case Keenum comes in, and this team wins in Houston, in Tennessee. Like, that just shows the layers of the stuff that they got, man. Like, Bobby Slowick is the OC. There's a good chance that he is a head coach next year. I kind of want him to be the head coach of the Chicago Bears, just saying. He is from that Shanahan, McVay, Mike McDaniel. He was also on the 2013 artist formerly known as the Washington Redskins coaching staff that had Mike McDaniel and Kyle Shanahan and Sean McVay and insert awesome and future NFL coach here. No wonder that team was dicing everybody up with Kirk Cousins, because they had a literal all-star team on their coaching staff. But anywho, just shout out to the Texans. And also in the loss, shout out to the Colts. Anthony Richardson being gone, like, in the month that he played, he showed insane flashes. And I know we're just talking about flashes with Justin Fields. Like, no, this dude showed athletic prowess, arm talent. Like, dude, remember how much we were gushing about Anthony Richardson in the first month of the season? Like, next year, there is a chance where this team again is going to be right back in this spot, fighting for a wild card spot. They have an absolute wizard as their head coach, Shane Steichen. Everyone's gashing them for that last play call. It's the right play call. Gardner Minshew just hits him in the nut. If he doesn't hit him in the nuts instead of hitting the wide receiver in the face, yes, the receiver should have, or the running back should have also caught the ball. But listen, man, the Colts, I think they're in a perfect spot as well. And the AFC South just has so many kind of awesome teams. We're about to talk about one here in a second with our eulogies, but yeah, man, just any final thoughts on the Colts before we move on?
Like you said, I don't necessarily hate the play call on 4th and 1. The execution of it obviously was terrible. There are a few things about that sequence that drove me crazy. And we talked about it yesterday while chatting. The entire drive, literally the entire drive, you hand the ball to number 28. Jonathan Taylor gets you some yards, gets you a first down, gets you some yards, gets you a first down, gets you some yards, gets you a first down. I don't know if they even passed the ball on that drive. I can't remember. If they did, it wasn't very many. So on 4th down and 1, your best player on offense is not on the field. Obviously, he's been a workhorse that entire drive, that entire game. Dude needs a break. But fourth down and one, season is on the line.
Especially because of how they handled. Remember, they went up, they tried to draw them off sides. They burned the timeout, which basically made the fourth down play the game.
I hated it. We talked right at the time. So in that situation, it's fourth down and one, and let's see. Was it just out of the 2 minute warning?
It was right after. Yeah. Yep. Because it burned it down to like a minute left.
Minute 20. I think it was about a minute 20 left, right?
Yeah.
Pretty much. Maybe a minute 10, something like that. So
yeah,
maybe it becomes fourth down and one with about 145 to 150 on the clock somewhere. If you just do a fourth down and one play within 15 or 20 seconds, there is still a minute 20 on the clock, minute 30 on the clock, and you have all three timeouts.
Instead, get the ball back. If you force a three and out, if you miss the fourth down and force a three and out, you get the ball back with like 40 to 50 seconds left still.
Yes. If not a minute, if not. So the fact that you wasted 40 seconds trying to draw them off sides and you burned 40 seconds, that's essentially what one timeout is worth in that situation is 40 seconds. So you lose that. And then you'd take the timeout at the end to boot. That right there is another 40 seconds that you will not be able to stop the clock. So essentially a minute 20 left, 40 and 40, about a minute 20 that they're able to take off and, you know, give or take a few seconds. They got a punt return. So, yeah, I mean, I get that your chances of scoring a touchdown, if you don't convert fourth down and one, I get it. They're going to be pretty low because you'll have to drive the length of the field again. But it is better than nothing, and you better. But to take Jonathan Taylor off the field in that situation, who's I don't know, probably guaranteed to get a yard, even if they know it's coming.
Yeah.
Or I mean, he knows how to catch the ball too. How many catches did Tyler Goodson have all season?
Not many.
I think it was six, maybe.
Yeah.
I think I saw something that was six.
Ryan Clark made a great point of like in that situation.
The throw was terrible. The throw was not good.
In that situation, you want to ride with your guy, which I get. I get it. I that's one, too, where it's like in that spot, ride with Jonathan Taylor. So I get it. All in all, my point was to say that was like the Colts, I think, are going to be okay.
Oh, yeah.
This they're is going to sting. This like stings. What'd you say, sorry?
I was just going to say they're ahead of schedule like the Texans.
Yeah, were. Absolutely.
They like did this is going to back up quarterback all season long. I mean, I like Gardner Minshew. He's a fun story.
What high level backup. High
did level you, backup. Did you see his like graphic coming back from commercial or whatever? Like,
no,
where they basically show a video of the guy like as a promo.
Oh God.
Oh, I'm not going to do it justice, but basically he is front and center of the screen. And like the city of Indianapolis is in the background. And he's just like,
yeah,
just looking all weird. And it's like, he's a fun personality.
Someone, if he is up, someone will pay him to try to maybe be a starter next year. I hope the Colts keep him because like with Richardson's play style, you need a good backup. I think, because I think with Richardson might be a lock to miss 3 to 4 games a year, potentially. I thought what they did with Minshew was admirable. I cannot wait to see the Anthony Richardson experience continue. I just want to see him play football games. He's only played like 5 football games ever. I really just want to see him continue to play football games because he is so awesome. I never thought I'd say that about Richardson. In my deep dive draft analysis, say that 5 times fast. You have no idea how just out I was on him as a prospect. I didn't get it. And then I really dug in like to the depths and I was like, wait a minute, guys, I think I get it. And then like it's week one against the Jags and I was like, I really get it. And then Nick, that Rams game, I was like, I get it, he's so good. and then he got hurt and I was so sad. But yeah, dude, shout out to the AFC South, except
oh my goodness,
the Jacksonville Jaguars. We are at a crossroads, Nick, with the long-haired man himself. And not just him. Yes, yes, today was bad. But this this organization as a serious entity, they basically decided to not upgrade their offensive line. They thought the Calvin Ridley trade that they made in the middle of last season was enough. They got lazy. And that comeback win in the playoffs and almost beating the Chiefs, at least giving them a game with a dinged up Mahomes, made them feel like they were there. But in realistic terms, I overestimated it. Most people estimated it. The Jags are a perfect reason, by the way, folks, of me admitting when I'm wrong, because I thought they were going to be the one seed. I thought they'd win 13 games. This team was average as hell. And yes, Trevor suffered a billion injuries, but this collapse as a whole is a facelift now and kind of a deep, like, autopsy on their organization and their level of seriousness. It's a level of diving in on Trevor Lawrence and some issues that he might have, which I don't think are that bad because I think the roster around him sucks. But he was bad today. And also this Doug Peterson, who when you actually just look at the wins and losses and without real context, he's had kind of a weird career. So, Nick, I throw it to you now. Where do we go with the Jacksonville Jaguars as a team? With Trevor Lawrence as a quarterback, with Doug Peterson as a coach, with this organization in whole after losing five of their last six and missing the playoffs, which from where they were 2 months ago is a massive disappointment.
A couple things. Obviously, we've talked about Miami and their collapse here the last five games of the season. It was bad, but not as bad as Jacksonville.
It pales in comparison to what the fuck the Jags did. My God.
We went into today with the chance of three Florida teams hosting NFL playoff games next weekend. We're down to one, and another one's not even in the playoffs. And it's the Bucks. Of all the teams coming into the season who were discussing having a home playoff game, I don't think the Bucks cracked the top 25. They were projected to have the third worst record this season.
I thought they were. I picked their under.
Yeah, I'll go back and look, but I want to say that I did too. So there's that. Last year, Trevor Lawrence, it was kind of our gimmick. He was running them down, but there is no doubt that he was just run down at the end of this season. Definitely dinged up. It absolutely played a role down the stretch. They lost some games. I'm trying to think. What was the overtime? Was it Thursday night game that they lost, or as a Monday night game?
The game against the Bengals.
Okay, the Bengals. When that was without Burrow too, right?
Yeah, that was like the second Jake Browning game.
Yeah, that was right. Because I mean, even before the injury, it looked like the Bengals were going to win that game, and then obviously when he got hurt and Beathard had to come in, they were still moving the ball and playing well in overtime and stuff like that, but. That was kind of when you started seeing some major cracks in the foundation, because up until that point, I mean, Jags were in play for the one seed 2 months ago.
If they would have won that Bengals game at the end of the night after that Monday night, Nick, they would have been the one seed. They would have been 9-3 and they would have been the one seed. My God, what happened?
I think there should have been some flashing red lights after that one. Maybe this team is in for a rough stretch coming down the stretch, which turned out to be the case. And then some of the other teams that they've lost to, I mean, the Browns put it to them. That wasn't hardly a contest in there as well.
The Ravens really put it on them.
And I mean, that's kind of to be expected. They have put it on a lot of different teams.
Everybody.
Which I will say, earlier in the year, I did call them as my one seed. I thought they look like the best team in the AFC. So I will, I think there was some disagreement there. But I also said, I think when Lamar Jackson was like plus 800 or plus 1200, like, yeah, I think Lamar's got a good shot at getting MVP this year. So I'll chalk those up as a couple Nick Brinks wins here. But but yeah, that's beside the point. I just wanted to throw that out there.
I can't believe we picked the Saints. We both picked the Saints.
We did.
And I guess they were alive going into today.
Yeah, and it came down to last week, right?
Today. Bucks lost.
Yeah, Saints beat the Bucks last week, right?
They did.
Oh, okay.
They killed them. They kicked their ass.
Yeah. So it did not come down to that. That did not come down. I mean, that kept them alive, I guess.
Yeah. My biggest thing with the Jags is like this is a crossroads offseason for them. You are going to find out if this team is serious by how they attack the offseason. I don't think they need to fire Doug Peterson, but they need to sit down and have a long fucking conversation with him as to why this offense looked like they did not practice all season long. The miscommunication on stuff, just it was a mess. It was a mess from the highest degree. And yeah, man, these are just like fundamental missteps with the Jags right now that need to be looked at. Moving on, one of these teams just fired their coach. I know they won in 9 games and almost won their division, but the other one could potentially fire their coach. The Falcons and the Saints. Big off seasons for them as well, and especially for Atlanta. For the Saints, maybe. The Saints, I think, just need an upgrade of their coaching staff. The problem with them is they continue to just punt all of this dead money down the road. Eventually, there's going to be a tailspin year for them where they go 3-14 because of all of the dead money on their roster. Like, they found a way to continue to be successful this season. So good on them. But, you know, they have a high-level receiver in Olave. Derek Carr has his moments. He was brilliant today. What are your thoughts real quick on these two teams? The Falcons, I think, are way more interesting because now that we know Smith is getting fired, like, imagine if they get Ben Johnson, the OC from the Lions. Imagine if they get Bobby Slowick, the guy who's the OC for the Texans. The OC for the Bucks, I love. He's a guy that I think could get some love. I think his name is Dave Canales, I believe. And he's awesome. So there are a lot of teams. Yeah, Dave Canales. Like, there's some good options here that are offensive minds still that could come in and fix that are interesting. Your thoughts overall on the NFC South eulogies that ended today?
I don't think Dennis Allen deserves to be fired. I think the Falcons with Smith, I think I agree with that one. I don't know. I can't remember. How long has Allen been there now? Is it 2 or 3 years? Have they both been there 3 years at their respective teams?
Yeah, I think so.
With Smith, I mean, we come from a fantasy background a little bit with, you know, the Sunday morning show and stuff. And it was kind of a joke all season about how badly mismanaged everybody felt like Bijan Robinson was. I just feel like he was so severely underutilized given his skill set. And I don't know how much of that played into it or not. They get this really good running back and don't really use him. And quarterback play is obviously a big question mark. But again, I mean, half the league's got a question mark at quarterback.
Yeah, and you could argue that the reason that I wouldn't have been shocked if they kept Smith is because you could argue that no team really was more shot in the nuts by horrendous quarterback play than Atlanta this year.
Well, what about Chicago? I'm just kidding.
Hey, man, I think Fields could be like the 23rd best quarterback in the league. I just think that Caleb Williams could be like the 7th. So, yeah, draft Caleb Williams. Or Drake May could be like the 9th. Draft him.
But, yeah, I mean, I feel better about the future of the Saints. Well, I don't know. Do I? Derek Carr, no. how viable of a long-term solution is he? Alvin Kamara is starting to age.
They can't upgrade the roster because of all the dead money.
Yeah, that's the big thing there. Is it a job that a new coach will want to come into?
Yeah, who knows? They're so weird.
I mean, if I am a coach wanting to come into a situation and both jobs were open, I think I would feel better about the Atlanta job, given that I would assume they have decent roster space given their roster. Nobody really jumps out at me as having like massive salaries.
The Falcons have, here's my thing on the Saints. They went like 7-10 last year, I think. Nick, they had all of this opportunity to finally cut bait, take your losses, eat all the dead money that they're accumulating, all of that stuff. And instead, they just kicked it down the can another year by making the Derek Carr signing. Like, this was the year to suck ass with the quarterback stop this draft. Now, listen, there's good quarterbacks potentially next year, and there's going to potentially be ones every year. But, like, man, they missed an opportunity. All for what? Two more wins and another missed playoffs? Like, if I was a Saints fan, I would not be happy. Tomorrow is Black Monday. Well, today, about to be 3 minutes away from Black Monday. We have already seen one casualty.
It was already Black Monday because it was 12:01 Eastern time for Arthur Smith.
And yes, it was, baby. I saw a guy tweet like 5 minutes into Black Monday. We're about to set records. Hey, man, this could be a generational day in the history of the NFL. Black Monday always delivers. All right. Give me, in your mind, now that Arthur Smith is gone, your next three highest candidacies to be open by the time we get to lunch tomorrow.
All right. Let me just pull up each conference so I can go down the list. Commanders, I think they're a pretty easy one.
And they were saying tonight on the broadcast, anytime they would go to the guys in the booth, in their 22-man booth that they have at NBC, they kept saying that the Commanders – we're going to probably be the next ones to, they thought the first ones. They didn't know that Arthur Blank does not sleep. And he said at midnight, like, yeah, bitch, see ya. They did not know that he had an email like pre-sent at 12:01 Eastern time to the NFL office. Like, yeah, we're moving on from our head coach. They were saying on the broadcast, they're pretty sure that the artist formerly known as the Washington football team is going to be firing Ron Rivera. So I agree with you in that one as well.
I'll say Commanders, Patriots. And man, a third one. Give me, I don't know. I kind of want to throw the Jets in there, but
I think they're going to keep, I mean, listen, extensions.
I don't know. I'm struggling to find a third one that I think they're going to fire their coach.
Tennessee.
Was there talk they were going to fire him?
People just think they're going to move on. Before they won today, they were coming into today, they were 5-18 in their last 23 games. And I don't think it's a Vrabel problem, but they need to like change stuff up potentially.
Yeah. Yeah. If I'm Tennessee, I'm still not necessarily cutting weight there. So, I mean, with how cutthroat the league is, I guess it wouldn't surprise me, but no, I'll take Patriots and Commanders as the easy favorites. And then I struggle to pick a next one, but I guess I'll take the Jets, but I don't necessarily think he'll be fired either.
They should though.
Is he on the hot seat?
No, he shouldn't be.
I feel like everybody in the NFC West will be safe.
Yes, they should. Well, okay.
Is he?
Pete Carroll. Huh?
I mean,
this is a, we, I didn't put them in here, but we could do a half hour on the Seahawks eulogy. Like, the fact that they went backwards this year, Nick, is wild.
But I mean, they also, isn't it safe to say they pretty highly overachieved last year?
Yeah, but they had the youngest defense in the league that we all thought would take a step. They got worse. And Geno played poorly to a degree. And I know they had some line injuries, but man, like, I don't know. That's a weird year for the Seahawks. I thought they'd be much better, and they weren't.
I don't see him getting fired.
Yeah, it'd be tough, right? But I don't know.
There's too much money in Wrigley stock for that to happen.
You're mean. I think the Bears are going to fire Eberflus. You think they're going to?
Yeah,
right?
I guess I might put him over the Jets, but I don't know. Did they see enough down the stretch here? I don't know.
You can't. After today, You can't tell me, like, after today, congrats. You beat the Panthers. You beat the Raiders starting Brian Hoyer. Remember when Brian Hoyer got a start? And then after that, they fired Josh McDaniels. Yeah, that's one of your top ones on your resume. They beat the Cardinals and the Falcons. Congratulations. Like, yeah, man, I think he's gone. Never say never. Doug Peterson, are you on the hot seat? Either. If they fought, listen, I think if they fired Doug Peterson, I would actually applaud them for being serious. Like, Doug Peterson was this isn't how they would frame it, but it would be like, Doug Peterson was a transition from the worst coach in NFL history to competency. Now we are firing him after a really horrendous end of the season to become a serious organization of now putting everything in the right spot for this really good quarterback we have. I don't think they will fire him, and I don't necessarily think he should be fired, but it's not one that I think is a crazy move. No way Zach Taylor should be fired from Cincinnati. He was awesome. The fact that they were 9-8 with everything that went wrong for them this year.
I was going to say, if anything, he should be getting a raise.
Antonio Pierce should get the Vegas job, but I don't know. Staley already got fired. Daboll, I doubt it. There's no way.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I don't know what to tell you about the Giants situation, but yeah, I don't think he gets fired.
They dominated today.
I look at things and I see two obvious candidates, and then
A
lot of just like, I don't know.
And the crazy thing is, one of them is going to.
Yeah, maybe we'll see a calm Black Monday.
It seems like one of them is going to eventually be the new coach of Washington. If you put two and two together there. No, I think we're going to have those are the first three. And then after that, I think stuff could get a bit weird. Okay. Real quick. Guess the lines. We're going to do a full preview on these games probably Wednesday. Regardless, they'll come out during the week. If we do it Wednesday, we might just do a recording of it, and then they will – I don't know. I feel like if we didn't do this show live, it almost wouldn't do it justice, right? We love the interaction.
At least the preview could be manageable. It's not like doing a recap on Sunday night should be tape delayed. I don't think that one – if either one could be tape delayed, it'd be the preview for sure.
Yeah, that is
true. Yeah, but yeah, then we miss out on the Bryans and the Jordans of the world.
Yeah. We have multiple Jordans, bro. The Jordan and the Jordans.
That's right.
All right. Guess the lines. We're ripping off the Bill Simmons podcast. First game is Texans-Browns in Houston.
You are way better at this. How about I just tee it up for you?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, tee it up for me. Let's go in order of the games.
Okay. Cleveland at Houston. It'll be a 3:30 Central game on Saturday, airing, I believe, on ESPN.
NBC.
That's they've got all Saturday NBC.
Which is wild, because that's weird that's not a CBS game. I'm going to go.
I always picture Saturday ESPN, but that was before the Monday Night Football that they get a Monday Night game. So they gave that one up, yeah. I guess.
Uh-huh. Yeah, this was the ESPN game. I'm going to go Browns by 2.5.
Do you want to throw an over-under out there? Or just line? Oh, just
nah,
spread?
I can't do totals. It's probably under 45, though. Somewhere. It's less than 45, maybe.
You get a double dinger. Mm-hmm. Minus 2.5 Cleveland.
Wow.
On the dot. And 43.5.
Okay. One for one. Shout out to me. Hip, hip. Hip. Hooray.
On Peacock, where the greedy bastards in the tower give us all their Peacock and make us pay for their damn streaming service that I ain't paying for.
Hey, man, when they break streaming records because it's the Chiefs and everyone wants to watch the Chiefs. Oh, yeah. It's all everyone was kind of bashing them for putting a team like the Chiefs on there. I think it's smart. If it was Bills Steelers, no one's going to go watch that fucking game on Peacock.
No, I totally get why they're doing what they're doing. I just hate that they're doing it.
It sucks.
Oh, yeah. Dolphins at Chiefs, 7 o'clock on Peacock.
Because of the weather.
0 degrees.
It's going to be cold. The weather is going to make the total like 41-ish. Like, because okay. That game screams like 20 to 14, and I don't think it'll be even that close. But the spread, the Dolphins have gotten love unless they play the Bills, who's the most overrated team by Vegas ever. I'm going to say Chiefs by 5.5, Vegas zone.
3.5.
I wanted to say that, but then I wanted to say in that range. Okay.
And 43.5 for that game as well. Favored to the under. The other game was favored to the over.
If that, it's at 3.5. Uh-huh. If that got to 3, holy shit, I'd lay it with the Chiefs easily. Not that I wouldn't with the 3.5, but like 3 is an absolute must, right? Don't you think?
I would think so. Okay. And on that note,
did you put this in here to DJ jump in and go?
I did. Rogue? I did.
Attaboy.
I say Tyreek by volume.
Here is a great comment from DJ earlier in the show. Can't take the player out of KC, but can't take the KC out of the player. They never had this problem before this year. All right, I'm 1-1. Let's see if I can get it better.
Yeah, how close do you need to be for it to count? Just within 1 point, or because you've been on the money, and you've been off by 2.
I'd like to say if I'm within a half a point.
Half a point. All right. High standards. Now this one has already fluctuated quite a bit since this game ended tonight for Buffalo. Buffalo hosting Pittsburgh.
Oh yeah.
Sunday at noon. It's already fluctuated, and I'll tell you from what to what in a sec.
I have no idea what the total will be, but I'm guessing Bills minus 11.5.
9.5.
Okay.
Started at 7.5.
Wow.
So some people got some, they got some early heavy money down and moved it. 9.5.
I'm in the midst of like, so last year the Dolphins
Bills are game, playing everybody close right now.
Didn't That's the Dolphins? Didn't the Dolphins last year, weren't they like minus 13?
They were. And they lost by 3?
6? 30, 3?
34-31?
Yeah.
With Skylar Thompson?
Like, here's the thing. Because it's the Steelers. They had a chance
to win it on the last drive, too. That still drives me crazy.
Because the Steelers have Because the Steelers have a poor quarterback offensive scheme, and they have a bad offensive coaching philosophy, there's a world where this is like out of hand, 38-6. But there's also a world where this is 27-20 and the 27-21 and the Steelers have the ball with 2 minutes left, down 6. Like, those are the worlds we live in. I would probably hope that it continues to climb. It's at 9.5.
9.5.
I would hope that this gets to 10 and then I would bet Steelers if I was doing anything on it.
Want to take a gander at the total?
God, this could be anywhere. It's probably at like 46.5.
For Bill Steelers.
Maybe. Or am I way under?
You're way off. 39.5.
Wow. Okay. And yeah, I guess you're right.
Of the weekend.
I was thinking both teams to 24. Yeah, you're right. My bad. I'm an idiot.
So then we move on. Sunday at 3:30 Central. Maybe, I don't know, there's a lot of good games. There's several good games, but Packers at Cowboys just feels like it's going to be fun.
I think the game of the week is going to be the one we come up with that we come to next.
Yeah, and you've got Mike McCarthy taking on his former Packers and vice versa.
Dallas
at home.
Dallas minus like a touchdown, right? Minus 7.
Yep. Yep. I spoiled that one for you.
Yeah, I think that's right. I would probably say 6.5. 7. If it's a full 7, you might as well take Green Bay.
How about the total?
Total. This one's going to be over 50. Like 51.5, 52.
49 right now.
Oh, I'd take the over.
Dallas might score 49. We don't know.
Yeah, I'd take the over. If any, what's a key number there? if 28, the key number there is usually like 52 and a half, right?
Yeah. 28, 21 is exactly how things stand right now.
Yeah. Once you get past like 28, 24, that's 52, right? So mm-hmm. once you get to like 52 and a half, those are key numbers. Anything under 52 and a half, I'd fire the over. So yeah.
And now we move on to Sunday Night Football. One just screams fun for a multitude of reasons. Rams, Matthew Stafford at Detroit, Jared Goff, the old trade from a few years ago. We get to see him in the playoffs, and it took 15 years, but Matthew Stafford finally gets a playoff game in Detroit. What say you, Joe Winkle?
I really want to say Lions -3, but I feel like there's a world that also screams where it's like 4.5. So I'm going to split the difference and do like 3.5.
Your gut was correct initially. Three points right now.
Okay.
And our total? God, how you feeling about that one?
Probably still low 50s still, right?
Yep. This will be our highest one of the weekend as of now.
51.5? 52.5?
51.5.
Yeah, that'll be easy. Yeah. That game's going to be so good.
And then we move on to Monday night. Kind of surprised. I think you were surprised. I was also surprised that this was the Monday night game. But Philly at Tampa. Mm-hmm. The only playoff game in the state of Florida.
I think, yeah, no kidding. Could have been three. Wild. Could have been three Floridian playoff games.
Going into the day, it was three.
There could have been half of the games in Wild Card Weekend. We could have been like, damn, the weather there is nice.
Uh-huh.
And it's January, but nope.
Instead, we get, well, Houston's a dome. That's okay.
Yeah, there you go.
But and then you get Buffalo and Kansas City.
Two domes. Holy shit.
Yeah.
Buffalo, okay. Kansas City, you have Dallas, Detroit, and Houston. Actually, domes and shitty weather. There's no domes, Florida, and shitty weather. That's the weekend.
Yep.
Okay. God, whatever this is. We're both taking Tampa, right, when we do the preview show? I mean, holy shit.
Of all teams backing into the playoffs, Miami included, outside of completely falling out of the playoffs, nobody fell harder than Philly.
Philly.
I mean, they were
and they're hurt. AJ yeah. Brown got hurt today. Jalen.
Oh, I didn't realize he actually got hurt. I just assumed he was like sitting for a lot.
No, he like messed his knee up. I don't know how bad. Jalen Hurts' middle finger on his throwing hand was throwing up gang signs.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Looked like Jameis eating W's.
Yeah, no shit. This line could be anywhere, because if it was like if Dallas was in this spot instead, this would be like 6 at least. You could also argue to me that Philly on the road with the way they've been playing should be laying less than a field goal, but it's also the Bucks and they've been so everywhere.
Yeah,
I'm just gonna say 4.5 or like 5. I'm gonna say 4.5.
2.5 right now.
2.5, yeah. Like,
yeah.
Like I said right before that, like the way
I think if you went with your gut every time, you would have been right.
Well, the thing, right before I said that, like the way Philadelphia has been playing, I thought, yeah, on the road 2.5. But then I took the extra 2 points. I thought in was what I thought Vegas would think of Baker Mayfield. Vegas is basically saying we don't give a shit who the other quarterback is right now for the Eagles. Their defense is terrible, and the Bucks at least have Godwin and Evans, and man, that game is going to be fascinating. If Baker shows up, we got a doozy on our hands. If not, then maybe the Eagles could get a cupcake. But the Eagles got lit up today, and they were trying in the first half.
Yeah, that's the scariest part. They were at full strength to start that game.
They called the dogs off after they went down 17-0. They started the game trying, and they were getting their asses kicked by the Giants.
And nobody got their asses kicked by the Giants all season.
Jesus Christ, they're in a terrible spot.
Oh. Well, we're in for a fun preview later in the week. We're in for a fun Sunday or Monday night this week. since we'll, it's a Monday night game.
We'll do Sunday night.
Okay.
We did that last year. The Monday night game, I don't want to let an entire day go after that Sunday. Yeah.
Because I know last year it was also the Bucks, but the Cowboys, and we knew that was going to be a shitty game, which it was.
I said to myself, if the Cowboys lost, I would have came on to do a show because it would have been hilarious. The Cowboys won convincingly, so that was a boring outcome. Maybe if the Eagles lose, I'll come on and do a show, and if you want to join me, we'll do a little half-hour burial of the Eagles. But, yeah, Sunday night we'll go because that'll be the instant. We're going to be coming off of that Rams Lions game, brother. We're going to be ready to do push-ups on picket fences. We're going to be so jacked. I know your face is weird for that one, but a brisk 90 minutes, my friend. Thank you as always. Tell them nice things or say nice things to the people as we sign off or whatever. We need to do better at sign-offs, I think. I don't know. That's me. I got to get the puppies organized on that one.
I wish Miami didn't let me down, but at least Joe never lets me down, and neither do the viewers.
I know.
And listeners of Educated Ignorance. Thank you for watching and listening.
We had a day today. We had a hell of a conversation. We had a bunch of people in here earlier. I mean, goodness gracious, you people never disappoint. Hopefully you guys continue that. We'll announce on our socials when we are going to do the preview. It might be live, it might be recorded. We're not sure yet. Just depends on what day that happens and when we're feeling it. But we appreciate everybody that hung out with us tonight. Live show wise, guaranteed next Sunday night at we're gonna continue to be here through the postseason. And I don't think Nick has another kid on the way. So Super Bowl Sunday even, he'll probably be here with us. Oh my god.
Not that I'm aware of.
So I won't have to be as drunk on Super Bowl Sunday this year because I did a 20-minute rant about how right I was to the Super Bowl. This year I'll actually have to be coherent because we'll have a show and Nick will be here. But regardless, we thank you, everybody who hang out. This has been the Educated Ignorance Podcast. If you ain't got your game, you best pass the sticks. We'll see you guys midweek for the preview show or not. If you don't join that, we'll see you next week for the live show after the playoffs. Buckle up, everybody. It's time to ride. We love you all. See you guys. Have a good one.
Peace. Night.